All right, you're listening to Monday Night Madness. Everybody, listen. I got Everyday Dollars with us here tonight. I'm going to play some Homicidal first. This is some brand new Homicidal. Check this out. The song is called Tear You Apart.
We'll be right back.
Right, that was Judge with Take Me Away. I'm here with the guys from Everyday Dollars, and most of the guys. The rest will be here in a minute, but before I get started with this interview, Tomoki, guitarist of Everyday Dollars, he used to have a band in Japan called Dying Grace. This band is hard as fuck, and I'm going to play a song from their CD. The song is called Revive. Check it out.
Thank you.
All right, that was Revive from Dying Grace, Tomoki's old band from Japan. I'm going to get into one more song from that, but before I do, listen, everybody listening, you're listening to Monday Night Madness. This is Hellhound Radio. These guys came all the way down from Brooklyn to be here tonight, so I want everybody in the chat room, everybody listening, to tell everyone you know to tune in right now. Get everyone you know in here now, hellhoundradio.org. All right, I'm going to play one more Dying Grace song, and then I'm going to play a band called Uprise. Check it out. This song is called After All. Right, that was After All by Dying Grace. All right, right now I'm going to get into Rob's old band. This is called, well, the band is called Uprise. The song is called Carrier Flag. Check it out, Hellhound Radio.
We'll be right back.
right, that was Relapse waiting to happen. Everyday Dollars, and I'm here with Everyday Dollars right now. What's up, guys?
Yo,
what up, Seth?
All right. Tell me, how'd you guys get started?
How did we get started?
Yeah.
Talk in the microphone. Tagi-san, take this one.
Tagi, answer this one. Everyday Dollars started. About 2003, me and Rob were friends for a long time, wanted to do a band. We did a bunch of other different bands. We came up with the name Everyday Dollars. I knew Richie played drums. Richie started playing with us. And blah, blah, blah. It's 2010, and here we are.
Good.
Does that sound good to everybody?
Yeah.
You skipped all the band member changes that nobody cares about.
Exactly. Yeah, we went right to the point.
Yeah, I remember you guys had some other people. What happened to those guys?
Officially, Everyday Dollars came together in 2003, but officially 2006 when we got Taki and Tomoki. We don't need to talk about all the other people we had.
Why,
I don't think.
With them or something?
Nah, it's just irrelevant.
Give Richie a mic.
Yeah.
What's he talking
about? Give shout outs to all the ex members, man. Sean O'Brien, yo, what up, dude? Rob Conspire.
Metal Mark.
And
Anthony Bignell.
Anthony and Joe Affey.
No, bigger props to our fill-ins, Joe Affey and Jay Son.
Oh, yeah.
Those are fucking real dudes.
Yeah. Yeah, we have fill-ins throughout the time, too.
Hey, we got a show booked. Want to play with us? Rehearse twice, play the show.
Yeah, that's how it went, that one out for you. We had a CD release show, and we said, play with us. He practiced twice, learned the songs like that, and that was that.
And he made it onto your flyer.
The one show.
Yeah. Yeah, I didn't make that flyer. Sorry, Tomoki.
Tomoki's going to fuck you up later for that one.
I know, man. Sorry, man.
All right.
So, and who's in the band now? Like, everybody announce yourself and say what you play.
I'm a Taki, pretty bass.
Sean Money, I play guitar.
At least like that. Tomoki-san, guitar.
So he doesn't have to do that.
My name is Rich. I drink a lot of beer.
Rob Daly.
You good, we heard you.
He drinks beer too.
What was the very first show you guys played, and how'd it go? Where was it? Who was it with?
Rich, you take that one.
All right, we played a show in Philly with Wydai and Vision. It was the worst fucking pile of shit our set. I broke my pedal after the first song. I had to do the whole fucking set with one pedal, and at the time I was cheating, and I used 2 feet for everything. Now I could wing it, you know what I mean? I could Mackie it up, but back then I was fucking like cheating like a motherfucker. When it broke, I would just stop hitting the bass drum for a while. I was like, ah, fuck it. And the dude from Wydai's fucking drum set was like prehistoric. It was ridiculous. I couldn't even hit the fucking thing. Cymbals were this big. They were in the air. So I'm trying to do fast shit. I'm like, psh! It was like fuck it. Fuck that cymbal. I just hit the hi-hat the whole time. It was funny, man.
And what also made it funny is we booked the show, and then like 4 days before the show, our bass player couldn't play. And for some reason, I was so bent on playing that show, we had a fill-in. Our friend Anthony, who's a guitar player mostly, he learned the songs and filled in.
He did better than I did.
He probably did better than all of us, actually. But so it was a nightmare. So that's how that went. But
I've since improved.
Was that the first show you played on drums? You played for drums for another band before that?
I've only played in private.
Mm-hmm.
Oh wow! So I didn't know that.
First time in front of people.
Yeah.
It wasn't the best experience. It was sort of a unnerving to play on a fucked up kit with my shit all broken. But I was like, after the second song, I was like, you know what? This is so fucked up. I don't even give a fuck. I just winged it after that.
If the show's going to be bad, it's better the first than, you know,
yeah, better that one than when we play The Garden or something, you know?
When are you guys playing The Garden?
You're working with a booking agent on that, right? A big tour. We're going to do all the festivals.
Yep.
We're going to headline some festivals in Europe over the summer.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to come back. We'll do a couple of nights at The Garden. I think
Who else is playing that?
I think we're going to get Sick of It All open up for us.
Sick of It All's opening?
Yeah, I think so. All
right. Slayer on it?
No. They wanted too much money.
All right, yeah. I don't blame it. So tell me about this new CD that you guys got.
That's you. You're going to discuss that one.
Okay.
New CD. Talk about it. Sounds good. 10 people that heard it agree.
The new CD called The Age of Demand.
to in 15 songs or 16 songs? 15 songs.
That's the bonus track that's been going on the record.
Okay. I can tell that kind of stuff. And yeah. It's 23 minutes. I'll be serious. So it's like 15 songs, 20.
I think it's 27 minutes.
27 minutes.
23 is an EP, so don't say that. You gotta sell it as an LP.
You got a couple of songs that are just like 20 seconds, like punk as shit.
There's four songs on the album that are 30 seconds and or less.
That's good.
It was just, you know, just something fun we wanted to do.
Sometimes you have a short attention span, and those songs challenge that.
I got a lot of songs now. Like, I got a new band, we got like 20 second songs. It's right to the point. I mean, when hardcore started, there's a million songs like that, so.
Verse, chorus, fuck the rest. Ended right there.
That's it.
Sometimes it, you know.
And sometimes it wasn't because, oh, this would be so clever and artistic. I just didn't have anything else.
Yeah.
Well, you could have dragged it, made a 6-minute song out of it. Bands have done that.
Well, that's the thing. You didn't drag it. That's why, right to the point, the energy level don't die. So, all right, I'm going to play something from that right now. This song is called Punk as Shit. Check it out. We're back here with Everyday Dollars. Hold on a second. That was This Is Angry Part 3 coming up. We're coming off of their new album that's soon to be coming out. And when is that going to be coming out?
I don't know. Rob, what do you think about the new record coming out?
I don't know. We gave away the demo.
I was going to put it out on Satan Wears Suspenders, but unfortunately I had to drop Everyday Dollars from my label.
Was those guys hard to work with, or?
Really hard to work with, so I don't know.
Especially the drummer.
Yeah, I'm hard to work with myself, so unfortunately, musical differences.
It's all right.
Differences in direction. So I don't know who's going to put it out. Maybe maybe a really cool label, like fill in the blanks. You know you're all off.
Yeah, don't say that, dude.
Don't diss this one.
The thing is, we recorded these 15 songs. We finished recording them like a year ago, maybe longer. We picked 5 or 6 to put out as a promo. Figured we'd get like a little thing going on. Free download on the internet. And now we're just kind of sitting back. And
we're waiting for the little thing to start going.
Yeah, we're waiting for the buzz. You know?
Yeah.
Where's the buzz?
It's buzzing hard.
I hear a buzz. Turn the volume on this thing down a little bit. That's the only fucking buzz I'm hearing.
But as far as the 15 songs, I mean, we put everything into those songs. So it's not like some bullshit. It's like real shit. It's just that, unfortunately, there's either not... I don't know. I mean, we didn't kill ourselves giving it the labels, but we just figured we'd give out a bunch for promos, put a bunch out on the internet. We got
here's the truth.
I guess you're saying where we're at. No one's giving a shit. So
no one gives a shit, but here's the other important part, I think. I forgot what I was going to say.
It's all right.
And on that note, what song are you playing?
No, but if we put it out ourselves, we're a bunch of old dudes. We don't give a fuck. Like, what are we gonna do? We're gonna make 1,000 records and they're gonna sit in our fucking basement in boxes. Better to get somebody who actually
like
has a promo machine going. You know, let them fucking do something. Let somebody else do the work. So actually, I'm actually talking to a couple people. We'll see what happens in the next couple weeks as far as getting that out. Maybe even a joint thing. You know what I mean? But I don't want to just put it out and be like, we're gonna go to Bleaker Bob's and we're gonna Generation. Okay, here's 10. Okay, can you pay man consignment? And then we'll go to the fucking distributor and fucking waiting for the check. I don't have the fucking patience for that shit.
Yeah.
I mean, we all have jobs and shit, and we can't, you know what I mean? How much time can we put into going to record stores and doing mailings, and it's like, you know.
You think it's harder also because, like, everybody just downloads shit now? Like, it's harder to, like, get people to buy a record
probably,
or a CD?
I can't think of a fucking record store in New York City where I'd go buy a CD.
Honestly, yeah. I don't know. And I'll tell you why. Because, obviously, playing hardcore, we're not doing it to some millions or make millions.
Yeah.
And we put up the download, and what was there, 500?
500 downloads.
500 free downloads.
Is that good or bad?
Well, it's, you know.
And you know what? Most of the buzz of that is because we put it on the website. The hardcore website.
You might have got 700 or 800. 500 was the first couple of weeks. I haven't looked. I didn't give a fuck to look. How's that?
I mean, but we put, like, the artwork, like, the, you know, so everything's on there. It's a nice little download if you...
Yeah.
It wasn't very encouraging.
Yeah.
Exactly. We're going to do a limited edition 7-inch. We're going to make 75 copies of the 7-inch. 30 in blue, 100 in purple, and the rest in red with swirly marble.
The album was never even came out like officially on some label. Wouldn't even care if, like, you know, that promo download had, like, you know, 8,000, 10,000, like a real number. It's still minuscule versus Beyonce. We give a fuck.
Are we the only band that ever came in here and, like, talked shit about ourselves like this?
No, everybody does.
But I mean, it's like
people hype this shit up. Yo, it's doing good. Fucking shit's blowing up.
Part of our problem is that we don't take ourselves, like, we take our music seriously. Like, we fucking practice every week. We go to a great studio, record. We make the shit sound good. We go fucking crazy making it sound good, but then when it comes to the actual giving, you know, promoting it, or
we don't give a fuck
shows,
about that part.
It's like, can somebody else do this?
Yeah.
And not because we're lazy. I mean, we put everything into
it. Yeah, we're pretty fucking lazy, dude. To be honest.
But do we have time?
That too.
I mean, that is you. I mean, you know, we ain't 18 anymore. You know.
Yeah, I mean, it's like we don't have a bunch of 18-year-old friends that are gonna go fucking tell their other 18-year-old friends about it. You know?
Yeah.
All of our friends are like 35 and older, like, sounds fucking dope. It's cool. This dude thinks it sounds great, but he's not going to buy it. He's not going to come to a show. He's not going to mosh. He's not going to buy a fucking t-shirt. He's our boy.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's just like me. I don't go to every fucking show.
But he will download it.
And those 400 dudes who like us,
they
love
us.
They love us. But that's 400 dudes. That's it.
Just dudes?
Yeah, it's just, you know.
Probably, yeah.
And it's
hardcore.
Yeah, and it's like regular shows. Is there a lot of regular shows? I mean, I don't go to a lot of shows just because of my work schedule.
Yeah.
But it's not like, you know, when they're having shows at the Pyramid where, you know, every fucking once a month there'd be a show at the Pyramid where you can go and there'd be other kids there and blah, blah, blah. Or even CBGBs. There's nothing like that. I don't give a fuck what anybody says. There's nothing like that.
Yeah, that was the thing. Like, CB's every Sunday, you can count on it. In Jersey, at the Pipeline, every Thursday, you can count on it. And there's, people would just show up, no matter who's playing.
There's not one consistent fucking place that does shows. Like, a place where you could walk in, just everybody close their eyes, walk into CBGB's, take a deep breath, and it's like, ah, I'm home. Can't fucking do that. That died when CBGB's died. You know, period.
There's some kid.
I held my breath sometimes.
And I'm not talking shit about, like, you know, kids that weren't there to experience it, but it's like that, to all of us at least, and the people, our peers, people our age.
Yeah.
It's like everybody I know, you could close their eyes and just think of like a fucking awesome moment at CBGB's, and it's gone. It's fucking gone as soon as you open your eyes.
Especially in New York.
Especially in New York. I mean, you know, I guess hardcore's...
And then you got these fucking assholes with bombs, man. You know how many cops I had to dodge on the way here today in Times Square? They're all over the fucking place.
But it was crazy?
Yeah, man, there's fucking cops everywhere. I'm trying to drink a beer on the train. I'm like, it's like fucking crazy, man. And I'll come up the escalator, they're like looking in my bag. I'm like trying to tuck it.
There are no more shows in the Lower East Side.
Yeah, that's why there's no more shows. I mean, weren't they were doing shows at that fucking, like, the all-ages show on 6th Street and Avenue B, whatever the fuck that place was. Yeah. It's like there's not one consistent place for a bunch of people, like-minded people to go.
You have to say in Manhattan.
Yeah, I mean, they're doing shows in Brooklyn, but it's not consistent.
And even, like, you know, the Santos Party House, but that's still, like, every other month, that kind of thing.
If
that was every week, that'd be...
Those are more like big deal shows, exactly. Though. Like, you gotta get a ticket in advance, or you get sold out, you can't get in, it's like a bunch of fucking, you know...
That was
you can't just walk in there and hang out, it's not like that.
That was the beauty of the pyramid. It's like, there's a bunch of shows with a bunch of younger, new bands.
Yeah.
Maybe the dudes in the bands weren't younger, but there were newer bands, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, actually, I think the best show I've seen when you guys was at the Pyramid.
I mean, that was... I don't think this dude missed one Pyramid show. Could be wrong.
I live two blocks away.
Yeah, I mean, but makes it's like, it easy, you know, yeah. What I mean? It's like, there's just...
I went to every Pyramid show we played.
It's like, you know, even if, like, maybe there weren't the greatest bands in the world, you go, you fucking see people you know, you hang out, you talk.
Yeah, exactly.
Whatever, you know what I mean? But that's fucking dead.
All right, Rob, we got a question for you. Someone wants to know, what's up with the Uprise discography?
I had to drop them from the label, too.
You know, it varies month to month when I give a shit enough. So right now, it is coming out. It will be out. Like, but I have to master it just because, like, that's what I do, and I just don't care sometimes.
Yeah.
So,
Well, there's skinheads out there still, dude.
Am I explaining that correctly?
Yeah.
It's all in my hands, me physically, personally, and I got it all together. I mean, I've done a... Sooner or later, it'll be there. Probably in a few months. But I said that 2 years ago, so I don't
know. Maybe you can do it for the 25th anniversary.
Probably.
What year did you guys start?
Who?
Uprise.
86.
And then how long did it go for?
Just a couple years. It was broken up by fall of 88. Which, that's the pathetic part. The more people know that band than anything else I've done since. So, you know, it's fucking bad.
Everything's always bigger when it's over.
No, 16 to 18, that was, like, you know, musically okay. And
when did you sign Uprise MySpace page?
Was it last time?
Last time?
He checks it every 7 months or so.
6 months, come on. I don't fucking know. It's all part of giving a fuck, and that's... I don't know.
You guys all had other bands, so I want to ask you all about that. Like, what other bands have you guys all played for?
Where do you want to start?
Next is Rich.
I don't want to start. Fuck my old bands.
All right, Tomoki.
I don't remember.
There's a reason for that.
Sean,
how about you? You want to talk about some old bands?
Not really, but I will because Everyday Dollars covered. Covered. It's a stupid fucking term, but we did a couple Brick House songs.
What's falling in?
Brick House was a band me and Rob were in from like 89 to like 90. And it was me and Rob, guy from Dan from the Pagan Babies. It was like a bunch of... We were from Philly originally, so it was a Philly band. And we did a couple, Everyday Dollars covered a couple of our songs early on when we didn't really have our own material.
the crazy thing about Brick House, which I always say, was that spring of 89, there was nowhere to play. Mm-hmm. In Philly, everything was gone. Kennel Club and
Abe's Pizzazz.
They're all
gone.
Are
you saying hardcore was dead by 89?
Listen, the City
Garden,
a
controversial topic.
Shows. CB's stopped having matinees. So there was like 8 months. None of those places were having shows.
Yeah.
Nowhere to play.
And that's when Brick House was around.
And that's when we were a band. And back then, 8 months was a long time. You know?
And the thing that made us a little different at the time, we had two singers, which...
We played Reading, Pennsylvania.
Yeah,
they were having shows.
Like five shows in Reading.
Did you have to take your laces out?
I don't know what you're talking about.
They made me take my laces out at Reading. I said, I'm not doing that shit. Because they had a racist problem in Reading. So I had yellow laces.
What's that mean?
But
for the Steelers?
You're like Asian guys.
Asian power.
And that's why, to this day, we have two Japanese dudes. Because Richie always wore yellow laces.
But they had a thing with white laces or red laces was white power. And I'm like, well, what is yellow?
You know what's fucking
Does that
funny?
Mean something? And they were trying to make me take... I'm not taking this shit off. And then the guy...
Well, what were they saying? They were like, they were really saying like, yo, the yellow... What were they saying it meant?
They had a strong approach to it. And yeah. We played Bethlehem, Dark Side NYC, played Bethlehem in 92. Mm-hmm. And the entire audience was Sieg Heiling, like, on the regular basis. But at this show, nobody did it. And they had to take their shirts off and put them on inside out. And they had to take their laces off like they were in jail and put them in their pocket and walk around with no laces and their shirts on inside out. I was like, this is the most ridiculous thing I ever saw. It's fucking so fucking funny. You know what I mean? And that was the thing in Pennsylvania.
There what year was that?
Nazi shit. 92. There was so much Nazi shit going on that the club owners were like, all right, we're putting a stop to it, so take your laces off. But then I show up at the show, and I'm like, drinking fucking Ripple and talking jive, and they're trying to tell me to take my laces off. I'm like, come on, you got me wrong here, dude. And then the guys in line are like, they're from New York. They don't even know what the fuck you're talking about. They don't have that shit over there. We used to. But, you know.
Manhattan's different than Pennsylvania, for sure.
Yeah. Not a lot of hicks in fucking Lower East Side.
Speaking of Bethlehem, I got a show. I'm supposed to be giving away tickets. You guys are playing with Down Low NYC, Everyday Dollars, Not Without a Fight, Not Without Resistance, Sand, and Caught in a Trap. And this is Sunday, May 16th, the day after the Black and Blue Bowl. Where is this at?
I wonder if any Nazis will be in attendance. Probably a couple.
Just check the shoes.
Check the
shoes. Yo, lift your sleeves. Let's see what you got. Oh, shit, man.
Is that a Himmler on your neck? Come here, motherfucker.
See, I've lost track, though. Because it'd be like, oh, it used to be white laces, white power, right? Then, red laces. That's Nazi because it's National Front. I'm like, what? I don't even know what that means. No, yellow laces, white power. What? That...
Yellow was never anything.
Basically, any that's color you wear, someone could say that was white power. So that's why...
Not that we condone white power or anything.
So what could you wear?
Taki-san.
Yeah.
Does Everyday Dollars condone white power? Huh? Into the mic. Are we white power?
Are we?
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Are we?
Are you asking?
I'm asking you.
Not all.
Not all.
Why I'm here.
So, that says it all.
That sums it up.
Is there a white power problem in Japan?
Oh, I've never seen.
No.
Maybe.
Sledgehammer. Motherfucker.
That's not white.
All right, I'm going to play one more brand new. Actually, a couple more. Brand new Everyday Dollar songs. This song is called Everyday Battle. Check it out.
That was a good one. Check it out.
Yeah. want my money back. I'm down here drowning your fat. You got me on my knees waiting by, but then you lie. I ain't afraid of you. I'm just a victim of your fear. You cower in your tower, praying that I'll disappear. I got another brain. Will you drive me insane? All this danger ain't nothing. Don't need no microphone on me. And when you hear this song, if you ain't dead, sing along. Man, you're so dead, you're drunk. Do you got where you belong?
Right, that was Brick House that you were just listening to. What was the name of that song?
That song was called No More Favors.
We got a couple of questions. We got some people in California listening. They want to know, are you coming out to the West Coast at any time?
What do you think?
No, probably never. I mean, seriously.
You wanna fucking fly us out there? You wanna book us? Yeah, come on, the fuck out of here.
Let's talk about the finances. Of that. Really? Come on. You yes.
We'd love to, but
sounds awesome. We're not an ambitious band.
That MTV Super Sweet 16.
No.
Imagine if it was like this 16-year-old girl there, and she's like, we're like her favorite band, so. Makes her dad fly us out there for his one-off of 20 grand.
That could be interesting.
Yeah, so yeah, we'll play LA for that, sure.
That scenario happens, we'll definitely come out there. We'd love to come out there.
Yeah, we would love to play.
My brother lives there. Tomoki's got friends that live there. Joe V lives there.
We were actually offered a show out there, and it was for free. And I was like, I could play Brooklyn for free. I don't have to fucking fly out there.
Here's what would happen. If we were, like, realistically, like, oh, you got DIY, do it yourself. We'd play across the country, like maybe 20 people a night.
We can stand on the corner in the town square and give out passes.
Oh, dude, we'd get fucking maybe get to Cleveland.
Maybe Tomoki, you're moving out to California, right? You're gonna make things happen. You're gonna make some moves. Power
moves.
Met
lives out there. Maybe metal.
You know what? Never mind. Playing. What? Yeah, we're playing L.A. When?
Make some power moves, man.
It's up to Richie.
Him.
Matt plays drums.
Fill in.
Live stream, I'll watch it. I never saw Everyday Dollars live. This would be my opportunity.
All right. Next topic.
There's a question. There's a question where the answer went.
Where have you guys played so far? Like, just like basically like New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania?
All the hot spots.
Baltimore, right?
Baltimore. We like playing Baltimore. Philly.
We used to play Albany.
We've never played Connecticut. We haven't played Boston. And that's the thing. I'm being serious now, for once. I would love to play that stuff. And more upstate New York. More Long Island. We play there a couple times.
But if they don't want us, we don't go.
We want to play more Jersey. We play a handful, but not North Jersey or Central Jersey. We play South Jersey. It's a big state.
South Jersey's like... Got bigger shows now than North Jersey, right?
We wouldn't know. They're all little for us.
You know.
Well, I see lately, I think like Baltimore and Philly got like better shows. Like I think
right Sidebar's now. Cool. I like.
I love the Sidebar.
Maybe like three, four times. That's a cool place.
No, you got the Hustler Club right around the corner and shit.
Miss that.
All the hookers.
Yeah.
I think they. You know,
what do you like?
The LA thing is like.
Say that again.
What? I said kumbai kumbai.
You guys got T-shirts?
Dude, we got T-shirts in the trunk of my car right now.
What's that got to do with anything? What's that? Oh, everyday battle.
Everyday battle.
Okay. This story's half funny.
Oh yeah, everyone talk to the mic more. Everyone's saying they can't hear you.
Me good. Doesn't matter. So we have the song Everyday Battle. And we went in the studio and recorded it, and Richie did the count off on the hi-hat. Sounded great.
Don't know why I did that.
He freaks out later saying, well, you know, I have to redo that because I'd never do it on the hi-hat. I do a stick count. And I was like, I'm not re-recording a stick count. It's fucking retarded. Are you kidding me? But he's like, no, I always do it like that. And I said that.
And I was like, how funny would it sound if the song went tss, 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 ding, gotcha, dan, dan. So, it would be different, man.
Point is, I said, the only way we'll re-record it is if Jay from Caught in a Trap comes in and plays guest stick count.
Did he?
So that's what we did.
We called him up. Yo, man, come down to the studio.
Did he?
He came to the studio.
Yes, that is guest stick count on the fucking song.
He's going to get credit on the record.
Did you videotape it?
No, what are you kidding?
Can you prove it then?
He showed up, he got fucked up with us, he had a good time.
He showed up with two brand new fucking sticks too.
He's in a marching band, in like an Irish band, so he came, like, he wasn't wearing the kilt anymore, but he came from like a fucking parade.
Mm-hmm.
He showed up with two sticks, and they were fat as shit, and he's like, and the song like, started.
Do it again, that's something.
Do it again.
Song is it on?
Everyday Battle.
We had to make a stick count, coordinate click, 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 so he could come in correctly, because he was the count. So that's the ridiculousness of what we went through for that.
Now everybody that hears that can be like, this fucking guy's stupid.
I mean, some dudes have like guest vocalists, like big names in hardcore, like whatever, whatever. We got Jay calling the trap to his guest stick count. Fuck with that.
And sooner or later, if the CD does ever come out, probably won't, it'll say that right there. Everyday Battle, guest stick count, Jay calling the trap.
On the sticker.
Yeah, not even like liner notes, like in parentheses next to the title of the song, back of the CD.
Can I just say something really funny?
No.
All right, fuck it.
We'll just have silence for about 2 minutes.
All right, all right. You know how bands put on their fucking CD for fans of, and they name like big, huge bands?
Yeah.
And they the Slumlords put out a record and said, for fans of the Slumlords. That's the end of that. I stopped seeing that sticker after that. It got, that's how corny it got. Slumlords just shitted on everybody who ever did that. It was like so fucking funny. I have not seen that in 3 years. CD sticker for fans of such and such, such and such, and such and such. It's like,
I haven't seen a fucking CD for 3 years. I don't know what the fuck to compare it to.
I don't know either.
Yeah, that's why I was wondering. They don't even buy them anymore. So, outside of this May 16th show, what else you guys got coming up?
We're playing May 21st in Baltimore with Stout and Tomoki's boys, Sand from Japan. And I'm not sure who else is playing. And then we go take a summer vacation, I think. Tomoki's going to L.A.
Problem is, our touring schedule has been so extensive and grueling that we need a break. Mm-hmm. That's what's up.
We did like 300 shows in like a year, right?
I think we did three in 2009.
Yeah, we did
minus
2009, we did about three shows.
Divisible of 100.
We were like recording and, you know, whatever. But we haven't been playing out a lot. And there really hasn't been a lot of shows for us to play. So people are calling us up all the time saying, yo, play the show. But the funny thing is, we do get requests to play shows. Like, ah, fuck it. Ah, they're not giving us enough beer. Ah, you know. So
that's not true.
It is, actually, it is.
Yeah, we get just paid in beer. No money, just beer.
If it's in Brooklyn or New York City.
Just in beer.
I don't want to hear no bullshit about, well, I don't know if I can get beer for you guys. Well, then we're going to spend $200 at the fucking bar collectively. For $50 or $100, fuck you. I want drink tickets, motherfucker. We did a really good show, two months ago, at the Cake Shop. Matt Melnick booked the fucking show.
Mm-hmm.
Kraut, The Craze, Everyday Dollars, Step Too Far, about to break open the show. Every band got a pile of drink tickets, like fucking 15 or 20, you know, enough for like 3 or 4 for each dude. Everybody was fucking lit. Everybody was having a good time. Nobody had a shitty... Everybody got paid. Kraut got all their money. Everybody else split the rest. Everybody walked out of there like counting. You know, that was a good night, man. How come all shows aren't like that? How come at the end of the night, oh, I'm sorry, man, I can't pay you because, you know, I had this... I didn't hear no bullshit that night. What's up with that?
I spend...
You gotta book your own show?
$50 out of the cake shop.
You spent $50 on what?
For drinks.
You had fucking tickets.
You gave me only 2.
That's not true, man. I gave you 4 or 5, man.
And the funny thing about that is, if you show up with like some sort of writer, like a, we want this, we want that, they fucking people laugh at you. Who the fuck you think you are? But I mean, seriously, real bands have fucking writers that say we want this, 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 and this. But a band shows up, we want a case of beer and. You know, money for gas, and it's like, well, you know, we don't do the case of beer. One time we played up in Albany, or up in Troy. What's the name of that place? Mike's place.
He gave me a case of Ballantyne.
We showed up at the Hudson Duster, and he had a fucking case of Ballantyne for this dude, which is awesome. Now, the guy owned the bar. So
the part that wasn't awesome is I drove there, and I had to drive home. So I was like, wow, that's awesome, and it sucks at the same time, because I can only have, like, 10 of them, not all 24.
But, like, that's rare. That doesn't fucking happen. People don't get paid in beer. I mean, I don't even drink, but still, I mean, people don't get paid in beer, you know? I wish we did, but we don't.
No, but I'm being realistic. We spend so much at the bar, you might as well just give us the beer.
Yeah.
Because the little pocket change for the gas or the $100, we'll pay more than $100 in the fucking bar. We're not stingy. We'll tip your bartender. You know? Hook it up, man. Make it right.
Yep.
We did turn down like 4 shows this month.
We did turn down some shows. But
you guys can open, and I can't pay you.
Yeah.
But, you know, and you'll be really small on the flyer. Like, the headliner will be like 150 point font, and you'd be like 2-point font underneath where it says the address. Nah, that's cool. I think we skipped that one.
We don't have an ego, but sometimes it's so pathetic that it's like, oh, we can't.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we all come from the same sort of thing. It's like, it's hardcore. We're all friends. Let's just, we're all kind of not gigantic. It's like, we're all together. You know what I mean? But it's not really like that in real life.
Sometimes. Yeah.
The Cake Shop was like that, but most shows, it's like the headliner, blah, 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 whatever. And you should be happy to be playing. Like, okay.
Thanks. I've been told that.
Yeah. Oh, you should be happy to play the show. Like, really?
Really? Yeah, ask me if I give 10 fucks about your fucking show. How's that sound?
Yeah. Now, I've heard about all the bad shows. What was some of the good shows outside of the crowd show?
Our best show was our first show in New York.
We didn't get to play that one, right?
You being funny?
Yeah, so we show up, Richie brings his drum kit, he's like duct taped together. There's like some dude booked a show in the basement of the pyramid before they started.
It was Dennis from Fed Up.
Dennis from Fed Up.
Yes.
Okay, books a show in the basement of the pyramid. It's like us and 4 bands I never heard of. Like, yeah, it'll be our first New York show. So we get there, we're hanging outside.
People I know from years are like showing up, paying their $5. I'm like, you paid? Fuck that, man. I'm trying to get that $5 back, you know, get him on a guest list.
Make the story quicker.
Yeah, hurry up. Rob's getting impatient.
Nah, so we get this, so we're going to play, blah, blah, blah. It's the first show in New York. And then, bam, there's a huge fight right in front of the fucking police. And the dude's like, you guys aren't playing. It's a wrap. So that was our first New York show.
Show's over.
That was your best show?
But definitely. You should have seen this one kid's arm.
Yeah, this dude's arm was like, fuck.
It was like on the curb, and I stomped on it, and it was like right there. Elbow, like, you looked at it and you're like, ugh.
Wait, what happened?
Right here.
Well, he punched a girl in the basement and she got knocked out cold. So dudes punching girls out usually gets you an elbow in the wrist.
Yeah, so anyways.
Or worse.
His arm was jiggly.
Yeah, so that was...
We might be fucking this up a little bit. I don't remember exactly what happened. Okay. But it doesn't matter. What happened, I duct taped the drums and then I had to tear the duct tape off without playing.
So what was the...
What was our best show? I don't know. We had a good show with Murphy's Law and in Baltimore. That was a good show. It's a good crowd.
Sidebar or?
It's a sidebar, yeah. Killing Time shows we played with, they're okay. We usually... I don't know. I think the Sidebar Murphy's Law show might have... No, you know what? How about that...
Punk show.
The Punk show with Violent Society.
In Philadelphia. That's the best one.
It was fucking like lawless. It was like 16-year-old kids... Fucking drinking beer, like any second, license and inspection could have came in, close a place. There's like dogs walking around.
There were like 6
punks.
If you can believe this, there was about 50 people circle moshing, chicken riding, going insane. And I was like, and they didn't even know what the fuck we were. They just liked what they were hearing.
Yeah.
Nice. And that's what it used to, that's what I remember coming to shows the first time. That's how shit was. I didn't know who the fuck this band is. They sound good. Let me go mosh. You know what I mean? Now it's like, let me stand there. I don't know these guys yet. They're not, I'm not sure if they're cool. Maybe I can't be seen like
who
getting into
friends
the
with.
Fuck that. Yeah. Punk rock, man. Fuck hardcore. Punk rock shows.
It was a good show.
That's what's up.
15-year-old kids selling beer. It was lawless. It was great. It was just like, there was no rules.
I didn't like the beer they sold, so there was a place around the corner, like a beverage place, where on it they had fucking balance. Oh, look at that, man. Came out, rolled in there.
Rolled into a club.
I came in with a case, my own case, which we drank.
It wasn't a club. It was like a
lost. It was not a club.
It was a spot.
Yeah.
It was an illegal spot with the gate rolled down.
And there was like houses. It was in a little, you know, working class neighborhood in Philadelphia. Houses, like, right on the block.
Full of dirty gutter punks, but they were well behaved. They knew that you couldn't fuck around outside, so they did all their fucking around inside. When they went outside, they were like fucking angels. Walked on the block, single file, you know what I mean?
FOD played that show too, that's right.
FOD.
Yeah. FOD and Violent Society.
And Hate and War played too. They were pretty cool. Before that, we weren't there yet, so I don't remember.
But those are the shows where like we're not sure if it's going to be good. We're like, oh, is this going to be good or is it going to suck? Never heard of the place. walk in, and there's a fucking bunch of kids who are fucking into us, buying shit. Like, you know, it wasn't some pretentious bullshit, which a lot of times is how it is. You know what I mean?
A lot of times it's better, I think, playing in front of kids, like, for that reason, you know? They're out of control. They're just getting fucked up. They don't care. They dance more. They ain't just, like, standing there the whole night, you know? But, yeah.
Well, we play music for 40-year-olds, but occasionally you don't want your audience to be 40-year-olds.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? What a 40-year-old stand and go, woo! Fuck that. What are you looking at?
We play music that we listened to when we were 18, you know?
Yeah.
That's what it is. That's exactly what it is.
Well, some of the songs on the first album, they were old songs. You wrote them back then, right?
Yeah. Well, there's a couple songs. Yeah.
A handful, yeah.
Yeah. Songs that we did in other bands. They're not covered. You know, it's hard to say it's a cover song when I wrote it or he wrote
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
All right. I'm going to get into some more music from that first album. And this song is called Bad Things. Fuck.
Is that for, like, the sensors? Like, in the front?
Yeah!
All right, we're here with Everyday Dollars, and right now I'm going to talk a little bit with Taki and Tomoki, who are from Japan, and they're going to talk a little bit about the Japanese hardcore scene. So tell me, talk to me about what's going on. Well, give me a little history on the Japanese hardcore scene. Like, talk about it back in the day, talk about it now, differences. I don't know, say anything, man. Not to put you on the spot, but...
It's a long story, man.
For me, not long story. I'm from countryside. He's in.
Yeah, where in Japan are you guys from?
I'm from Kobe.
I'm from Kyushu, Kagoshima.
And Kobe was right by Osaka, right?
Yeah. It's a half hour.
Mm-hmm.
Osaka, like a Brooklyn and the Queens.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was like, what, like 10 hours from Tokyo, was it? Something like that.
Yeah, 7-8 hours drive.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's far.
What do you like better, the Osaka shows or the Tokyo shows?
I really don't know about Tokyo.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, we had play maybe 5 shows in Tokyo.
Mm-hmm. With Dying Grace?
Yeah. It wasn't, you know, great shows, but we from Kobe.
Yeah.
I'm from Kobe. So Dying Grace had a lot of shows in Osaka.
Yeah.
So.
Bayside Journey?
Yep.
That place still around?
Nah, they closed.
Ah, oh, yeah, man.
Sucks.
How is the scene out there now? Like, because I remember, you know, when I was there in 97, it was off the hook. It was great.
think, you know, strong, but mm-hmm. they got smaller.
Mm-hmm.
You know, same here.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had a good hardcore scene in the 80s.
Yeah.
And the 90s.
Mm-hmm.
But 2000, no.
You think it's making any sort of comeback at all, or?
You know, it's say it's cycle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You went back out there with Everybody Gets Hurt.
Yeah.
What was it like going back with an American band?
It was fun.
Yeah.
But we were in 10 days in Japan, and we did 9 shows, so.
You played everywhere then?
Yeah.
You did Tokyo and...
Yeah, we did Tokyo, Nagoya, Osaka, Hiroshima, Fukuoka, Sapporo, Kyoto, Yokohama.
What do you call it? So tell me about Dying Grace. When did you guys get together?
Dying Grace. Who was in the band? I started like the music in 1997. And I don't remember.
How much did you smoke tonight?
What?
How much did you smoke tonight?
A lot.
A lot?
Yeah.
2 blunts, 3 blunts?
Can't say. Hey, it's a lot.
Yeah. What about you, Taki? Do you have any bands in Japan?
People. I don't want to talk.
No, I got bands like that. And I never even told you about them.
I forgot the name and crappy. No demo tape.
Oh, all right.
Nothing.
No. Or no demo tape that you're telling anybody about.
All right. Why not? Just in my town, in the city.
But then you had a band in Boston.
Yeah.
Cease to Exist. Tell me about that band.
Yohei.
Yeah, Yohei. Yohei.
Yohei was in that band?
No, different Yohei.
Oh, not different Yohei.
Yeah.
All
right. Yeah. He went back to Japan.
Okay. He went back to the
No. All right. Another
Yohei. All right.
Yeah, and he has a band, the Yohei, from Cease to Exist.
Mm-hmm.
A band called Lifestyle.
From and, they're in Japan now.
Yeah, they're in Japan now, Kyushu. Yeah, and actually he brought me to Boston.
Mm-hmm.
I think 2000. Just typical beat down.
I'm about to play it.
What?
I'm about to play some.
Oh, yeah.
How long were you guys together for, though?
I think 3-4 years.
Mm-hmm. And what did you guys record?
Huh?
What did you guys record?
What?
Yeah.
20 of demos.
Yeah.
20 demos?
20 demos.
Yeah.
All right, I'm about to play something. You got a song you want me to play? Actually, I got to make sure I have it. Where the hell did it go? I got the 2003 demo here.
Oh, yeah. That's the last one.
What song do you want me to play?
Last one.
Okay. Yeah. This song is called Lost All Hope. This is Cease to Exist. Taki's old band. Check it out.
Thank you.
All right, we're back here with Everyday Dollars.
So is anybody saying anything awesome in the chat room?
Well, some people are asking about what I just played. They want to know, are those demos still available? Is there any way to get those?
They're sold out on iTunes, I heard.
Oh, yeah. Just hit up Taki's cell phone and he'll send you that.
And also, they want to know, what bands in Japan should people be looking out for?
Gauze.
S.O.B.
Jism.
Dying Grays.
Nuki Pikes.
Richie cool. knows more about Japanese
Bastard.
Hardcore than he's
Rose. Yo, so many fucking bands, man, from Japan. Death Side.
Paint Box.
Oh, yeah, Paint Box.
Paint Box.
Rise from the Dead.
Death Side.
Send them already.
What?
SDS.
You mean old?
SDS. Systematic
Should
Death.
Have or yeah, new. SDS. What's up? Old?
I'm only talking about old bands. I don't know any new bands.
Sand.
Sand.
Yeah, Sand.
They're not new.
Slang.
Slang.
Slang. Slang's been around. They're good. They're coming out here soon. Be on the lookout for that.
Slang.
Loudness.
TJ Maxx.
Easy O.
Easy
O. What about Japan X? They're in that global metal movie. What are you guys like listening to like lately? Like, not like what you like, not influences, but like what's in your CD players right now or MP3 players or whatever.
Fortunately, nothing new.
Hey.
No diss to anything new.
No, I'm just
listen to old shit. I mean, it's the stuff that influences me is what I listen to. You know, Warzone, Side by Side, Leeway. That's what I listen to. I don't have my pulse on exactly what's going on right now, but
your pulse.
That's what I listen to, personally.
I have a new Cypress here.
New Cypress Hill.
They have a new one?
Yeah.
Are they all in it?
Two. They probably have like eight after that one.
They're good. I love them.
Well, you're also into the same religion that Cypress Hill follows.
Me?
Yeah.
None?
Cypress Hill and Tomoki, same religion.
Oh, yeah.
Smoking.
Smoky.
No
smoke.
I don't smoke.
What?
I don't like any new bands. Basically, everybody watching this, if you're in a band, I hate your fucking band. I literally think your band fucking sucks. That's just me talking. These other dudes might want to be nice about it. I'm just saying, I'm just putting it out there. Fuck your band. How's that sound? You don't support me, I don't support you right back, motherfucker. I listen to Discharge and The Clash and fucking Slayer and Negative Approach and The Necros and fucking Deep Purple. Fuck you.
Jeez. Well, besides that, and Lady Gaga, Wisdom in Chains and Razorblade Hand Grenade.
Yes, those are two bands that we listen to.
Okay, I can tolerate those bands.
Richie can tolerate
those bands. Are okay.
Your time's
really
done.
Like they're really good.
They're my
and
boys
they're
and
dudes.
Yeah.
And my favorite bands.
Yeah.
For real, favorite bands.
We played Wisdom in Chains a bunch of times, and we played Razorblade a bunch of times.
Yeah, first time I saw Razorblade was with you guys.
Where's that at?
Pyramid.
Of course. Fucking Pyramid.
I think like 3 years ago or something.
When did the Pyramid?
I think I remember that show.
I don't remember who else played, though.
Was that like a big headliner for that
headline.
One?
Headline. What?
I don't think.
All right, AKA going on last. But, you know.
Are you headlining or going on last at that point? I don't know. I don't remember. I don't know what show that was.
How long has that place been shut down already? I think this show was like 06 maybe 07.
Nah, CB's closed in 06, didn't it?
Yeah. It was before Tomoki was in the band, but I think Taji was in the band.
You play with us. Yeah, but our show or when?
That show that I saw you guys at the Pyramid.
Oh, yeah.
I think the first time I seen you guys was at CB's.
What was that?
Which one?
Homicidal, Sub-Zero, Neglect.
My kids were at that show.
Yeah.
With Joe Affy. On guitar.
No, Joe Affy didn't play guitar that show.
No, Conspire.
Rob Conspire.
Rob Conspire played
Jason,
guitar.
Jason and Rob
And
Conspire.
Jason played bass.
We went through a little period where we were a four-piece.
No, Sean O'Brien was on stage.
Yeah, you know what? He's right.
So he played bass.
Yeah.
Me and Tomoki were in Homicidal for that show.
Yeah. That was Sean O'Brien, yeah.
I think I used your drums, right?
No one used
No, you didn't use my drums.
I think he bought his drums to one show. In 6 years.
No, I put them through like at least five or six.
Yeah, okay.
This is boring to everyone except us. You know that, right?
You know what? Who's in the chat room? Three people? Fuck everybody who's watching this fucking thing.
We you heard it here.
I think
here.
The only people watching it are your wife and Jovi. So they just said, fuck you to your wife and Jovi. Just
well,
saying.
They understand.
Jesus.
So, everybody else is watching it. We're having a conversation here, fellas.
Man, there you go. Fuck you too, Richie. I think someone just said, fuck you too, Richie.
Yeah, that was Joe.
Jovi.
Hold on a second. We got some questions here.
Oh. You're ignoring the questions. I'm sure Jovi wrote like 30 questions and you're just not looking at the screen.
What else is? Ask Rich if his kids are starting a band.
Well, I might need a drummer soon. So I'm teaching my kids to play the drums.
How old?
10 and 12.
They could do that.
Maybe
then
they get tired. So like let one play the first half and then the other one play the second half. You know.
They're actually playing now though?
Well, they play in the band.
Mm-hmm.
They're in the school band. They play trumpet and saxophone. And they can read music, something I could never do.
Do they get into, like, any hardcore or punk rock or anything?
Yeah.
Because I try to get my little brother, he's 12, I try to get him into that shit. He hates it.
No, well, they've heard it in the car and in the house so often. They like certain shit, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
What's weird is my older one, in school, she doesn't relate to the other kids because they listen to the same bullshit. They all listen to the same fucking Justin Bieber song, whatever the fuck. So, you know, she knows DRI and Black Flag. Like, she knows that shit, and they're just like, who the fuck is that? Like, it doesn't make any sense to them. I mean, she likes the Zero Boys. Like, who?
That was probably like you in school, huh?
No, I used to get called Satan, and I was fucking beaten up until one day I stood up, and I'm not taking it anymore. And I power drove a kid into the fucking tile, and then they stopped fucking with me. But they called me Satan. That was my fucking name when I was 11. I was in military school. I lived away from home, and they fucking fucked with me and called me Satan.
What'd you look like then?
Skinny as fuck.
Long hair?
No, man. Military school. Oh, yeah. I cut my hair every 2 weeks. That shit wasn't no fun. Then I had to get kicked out of there so I could fucking live a life, man. But the day I pile drive the kid into the fucking tile, they stopped fucking. Oh, shit. Oh, my God. Oh. But you got to step up for yourself once in a minute, you know?
What were the bands that you got into, like, at a young age that got you into, like, punk and hardcore and metal?
For who? For me, personally?
All of you, but one at a time.
You.
The Doors. AC/DC.
Fast forward 10 years.
No, I'm going to get to that. Quickly, if you shut the fuck up, I'll fucking hook it up. Sabbath, Priest, Maiden, and then around the time of 85 or 86 or so, thrash metal popped its head up, Metallica, Slayer, that kind of thing. A year or two later, I was into punk rock and hardcore and thrash metal, and I kind of gave up on regular metal for a couple of years, and I was just really immersed in like punk and hardcore and thrash metal, early death metal. All the bands. I don't have to name them. Everybody fucking knows who the fuck I'm talking about. You know what I mean? And then sometime around maybe 93, 94, I revisited original metal and I was like, oh shit, I came full circle.
Yeah.
And ever since that day, I've been very well rounded. Now I listen to all kinds of crazy shit, man. You know?
Well, like, I know you're into like a lot of blues shit. Like, what else are you listening to?
Blues shit, man. Howlin' Wolf.
You got me into Screamin' Jay Hawkins.
Screamin' Jay Hawkins is crazy, man. People got to be up on him, man.
Hell yeah.
Little Walter, John Lee Hooker, Buddy Guy. I seen Buddy Guy in concert. Blues is good, man. You got to know about the blues, man.
Yeah.
Lead Belly.
That's where it all comes from.
Old fucking Blind Willie Johnson.
It all.
Are you snoring? I'm sorry. We all can't talk about token entry all the time, Sean.
Let me tell you what happened. In the blues days, if you weren't...
Remember them? You're old enough, motherfucker.
If your girlfriend didn't throw a lie in your eyes and blind you, you're a pussy. So, if you're blind, you have the street cred. Fast forward 40 years, you had to be shot as a rapper. So, having gunshot wounds as a rapper is the same equivalent as being, you know, a half-blinded blues guy.
How about rappers that feign their own gunshot wounds so they can get in the newspaper and sell records the week before the release date? Ah! Let me tell you something, man. These fucking cops in Times Square drove me fucking batshit today, man. This asshole with the... I wanted to string him up by his balls and fucking fire darts with AIDS on the tip at him, man. Fuck this guy with the bomb scare in Times Square. I fucking hate this guy. I don't think so. It would be bad. Fuck this guy, man. You know how many cops had to dodge on the way here? Fuck this guy.
Was it all about the South Park? Was that what, like...
I don't know, but I want to fuck those guys up too, man. Get a sense of humor. Fuck religion. Gives a fuck. It's old as fuck, man. Who the fuck knows about that shit?
Remember? That's bad. Remember?
Just saying. Sorry. Taki, what do you think of religion?
Religion?
In religion.
Japanese. We don't
want to
get...
Yeah.
In
Japanese?
Yeah.
That's right, Muslim.
He said, religion is for the weak.
Yeah.
I go to church every day, every Sunday.
I'm Christian, did you know that?
You're out of the band. We're gonna play a song, well, we're talking a lot of shit here.
Alright. I got a lot of music here, and I don't know...
Would you happen to have a high E string?
You're on the air.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Come on in. Say hi to the people.
Hello, folks.
Yeah, the hot band for the big gig this week.
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to play something, and Rich brought a CD, but it's not labeled, so I don't know what we're playing, but track four.
You'll ignore all, like, oral bands.
Not next week.
All right, we'll see what this is. After we play it, we'll tell you what it is.
Not no more favors.
All right, thanks, guys.
Hopefully it's not.
Fight your fight to the new day, but nobody cares about what you say. Tomorrow and Friday, you'll be dead. What is what you say?
New day.
Well, I'm not sure of my fucking dreams, but all the money that I have, I want to keep. I'll be making fun of it so many times. Now it's going to go, never move their why. Ooh, that's a good advice, make a better get right. Then you got to go, keep it in the dark, that's it. Why don't you make it go, make it more, make it go. Now you sell it on me, so you're a champion. So what you do? You're a shitter. Battling without a battle,
All right. What you just heard was a bunch of stuff that Rich just brought in here.
I try to hook it up, man. That was DRI live at CBGB's 1984. I Don't Need Society before that. I might be fucking up the order a little bit. Who gives a fuck? I had the Abused demo. Just Another Fool and Watch Out. And we had Rest in Pieces, an outtake from the 7-inch spooky song, Crumbsuckers demo. It was either Trapped or Schitt's Creek. I forget what I put on there. Yeah.
All right, now Joe wants to know about the time, Rich, that you were so drunk that you fell off the drum stool.
That might have been in practice. I don't remember that. Maybe he can illuminate us on that fucking matter in the chat room.
I gotta wait. Also, there's a delay on it.
Yeah, I don't. If I fell off the drum stool, I don't remember it. Why would I remember that thing? I would block that out, right? I would suppress that.
You know, for a long time, my biggest worry was like this dude, Richie, showing up drunk. So drunk that he couldn't play, and fortunately
it happened a couple times.
It happened a couple times, but it happened one time in particular at Manitoba's, where he was mixing some shit all day for some other band shit, and he showed up fucking wasted. And it was funny because like it was Manitoba's, and I think it was with Sub-Zero, and like we knew everybody there, and everybody know Richie, and it's like he'd be like, bleh! Like, ah, oh, Richie fucked up. Ah, Richie fucked up. Like, everybody's laughing and shit. Like, it didn't matter. You know what I mean? But if it was like in, like, This Is Hardcore 1 where we played and Richie fucked up, there would be a bunch of dudes like, he's fucked up.
Bunch of elitist fucking snobs.
But because it was at Manitoba's and everybody else knows Richie, he got a pass.
I got a ghetto pass.
But,
Where you going, Tomoki?
But yeah, I mean, everybody in the band, obviously, except for me, he likes to drink and get fucked up. Tomoki got walked out, making mad noise and shit, but that's cool.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Joe says it was at practice.
At practice. But that don't fucking count, because he gets wasted at practice all the time.
Type in, which piece of shit band?
Which piece of shit band?
Hey, Rob, why all the hate, man? It's not 88, you're a hate anymore.
Oh, man, that's fucking funny. Yeah, practice is a whole other story.
Practices are fun.
Yeah.
The ones where you come to them, you're not like, I'm sick, I can't come.
Ask Taki about Japanese hardcore. All right,
he already answered that question.
Oh,
no.
Yeah.
You asked 88, ask
94. I have a question. Seth, can I ask a question?
No more questions.
Taki. What is the worst thing about being in this band?
In the mic.
In the fucking door.
Yeah, everything.
What's the best part?
Best part?
Yeah.
Why do you still play in it?
Ray, I'm always asking to me.
I think Taki, I'm going to answer it for him. I think Taki's favorite part about being in Everyday Dollars is it right down the block from a practice spot? A place called Wakamba Lounge?
Oh, yeah.
That's Taki's favorite part about being in Everyday Dollars. Because Wakamba Lounge is this, like, shitty dive bar.
Quiet.
But they got, like, these...
Chill.
Is this a good
These
place?
Really cool bartenders who serve really good drinks. And half the time, Richie and or Taki are the last dudes at the fucking...
That's only happened about 3 times. That's not an often occurrence.
It's a good bar. They like to go there. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yep.
Sometimes I get a buyback, you know?
Dave's is better. Yeah.
I feel like something's not being said.
Yeah. That's cool.
It's all good, man.
It's all right. I won't push it.
No, but it's a, you know, these dudes, it's like Monday night, it's like we hang out and it's,
Monday is my Saturday. I don't go out on the weekends. I got kids, man. I got 3 kids. I got a wife, and they want me home doing stuff. So fuck it, man. Fuck hardcore shows. Monday night, I go to rehearsal, and after rehearsal, I have a couple beers. You know?
That's the thing about this band. It's like we're all boys. Like, it's not like some bullshit where, like, this dude doesn't talk to this dude, and that dude doesn't. You know what I mean? It's like we're involved in each other's shit. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I have a block party. They're invited. Sometimes they blow it off, but usually they come. You know? You want to come to a block party this year?
When is it?
August 1st weekend.
I'm down.
Come, man.
We're in Brooklyn, right?
Yeah, man. Yeah. Flappish. Come over, brother. Fuck all the nonsense, man. We'll do a radio show on my block party.
That's a good idea.
Hey, you got to go off-site sometimes, man. Stuttering John did it. You can do it, too.
All right.
Do you like Howard Stern?
Do you like Howard Stern? I used to, but I haven't listened in like forever.
Since he left terrestrial radio.
Yeah, basically. I don't got serious.
I forgot he's even alive. Unless you got XM or Sirius, whatever the fuck he's on.
Yeah, I mean, I see some in a clip sometimes, you know, but like, yeah, I can't just turn it on anymore.
He got boring, though. He got rich and famous, and he got boring.
Unless he has the Iron Sheik on. You ever seen him with the Iron Sheik?
You know, I saw the Iron Sheik wrestle 20 years after his heyday at an unknown, like, spot at Gleason's gym. He wasn't even billed as the Iron Sheik. He was just like a random dude, like, getting paid like to wrestle some dude. It was like, wow, that's my future.
He used to work there at Webster's, remember? Yeah. Like, in the mid-90s.
Yeah. He did WrestleMania in fucking 85. And in 2000, he's in Gleason's gym under an assumed name fighting some unknown dude. Like, that's what we got to look forward to, Seth. That's our band.
It's like Twisted Sister.
In 96,
no, they're popular still.
The top guys.
And
like Dee Snider.
He's there at the door checking your ID. So.
Yeah,
and that's not a diss, because, you know.
Yeah, the guy checking your ID makes more money than the band playing inside.
No, YouTube Iron Sheik Howard Stern.
Oh, yeah,
it's the funniest thing.
I will humble you. Is he doing his shtick?
Yeah, so
anyway, I don't know what this has to do with Everyday
Dollars. I like guys that do their shtick. All
right, I got some shows I just want to announce real quick. May 29th at HBNYC, 18 Commerce Street in Brooklyn. You got Marauder, All Out War, Sicker Than Most, Golpe Justo from Puerto Rico, Pound for Pound, Slam One Down, and Heartbeat Still, and Diary of Demise. And if you want tickets, call 609-954-5725. Also, Bill Duke's Birthday Bash in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, at St. Bernard's, which is at 333 Broadhead Avenue. I think the same place, though. Same place, different date. This one is going to be July 9th. No Redeeming Social Value. Download NYC. Manthrax, which I think they're like Manowar and like Anthrax combination or something. Red Eye Devil, Not Without a Fight, Troublesome.
Two more beers in there.
Animal House, and something else that I can't read on this flyer.
No. Nothing.
And then again, May 16th, Download NYHC, Everyday Dollars, Not Without a Fight, Not Without Resistance, Sand, Caught in a Trap, and that's also at St. Bernard's, 333 Broadhead Avenue in Church? Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. I don't know. That starts at 6, though.
If that's a church, we're going to desecrate it.
But that's the day after the Black and Blue Bowl, so everyone tune in for that. All right, we're just going to play a couple more songs, and then we're going to wrap it up. What are the rest of the songs that are on this?
I don't fucking remember, man. I think Ultraviolence is one of them. Maybe Ultraviolence is on there. I don't fucking know. I was in a hurry.
All right, well, we're going to find out after we listen to it.
I was for a half hour. I made a CD, and I rushed out to come here, so I don't know what the fuck I put on there.
All right, we're about to find out. Check it out.
We'll be right back.
That was Gauze pressing on.
You guys got any closing words? Anything you want to say before you guys get out of here?
I'm hammered.
That was Richie, and he's hammered. Thanks for having us, Seth.
Thanks for coming down.
Cool gig you got going on here. Cool place.
Can we come back next week instead of rehearsing?
Can we just come every week?
This is our rehearsal night.
So next week, we're going to have an interview with Everyday Dollars. That'll be, what's the date? What's today?
May 10th.
No,
anything but having to rehearse with these fuckers, man. I'd rather just sit here and drink and talk shit. You know, it's better. We'll do part two.
Okay.
Part two of the Everyday Dollars interview, May 10th at 11.
Dude, we got so much to say, we're going to come back.
We didn't say it all. We're going to say more. We were holding back, man.
Actually, the next week is going to be just Tomoki and Taki.
We'll stay in the hall.
And I think Takeshi's coming down.
We're going to hang out in the green room, and Tomoki and Taki will do all the talking.
That's a good plan.
Domo arigato, Mr. Robot.
Talking about Coco Jin, Okama, Yoparai, Opai, all day.
And Kumbai. May 21st will be in Baltimore with Stout, Sand, and I'm not sure who else.
And we have sidebar. And we have no New York shows scheduled in... fuck it. It doesn't matter.
EverydayDollars@gmail.com. Hit us up.
How about...
EverydayDollars@gmail.com.
How about... Don't even bother. Fuck it. You're not going to fucking offer us anything we're going to be interested in anyway.
T-shirts coming up.
New t-shirts coming
don't
up.
Don't bother.
T-shirts in the trunk.
Hey, if you want to come to the studio right now, before we drive away, you can buy a t-shirt. He'll overcharge you, but it'll be all good, man. It'll be original shit, man.
Well, thank you guys for coming. I'm going to play one last song. This is off the first album, Before the Supply. This song is called Now.
Going and going and going and going and going. Hey, don't do it, you're coming.